All right, a very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome and thank you for being here tonight at our monthly series, Librarians World, a monthly session where our librarians share their experience, insights, and thoughts on the area of their expertise. The National Library's Rare Materials Collection holds more than 16,000 items, ranging from 15th century works on Southeast Asia to early 20th century Singapore publications. So these materials are valuable records of Singapore and Southeast Asia's past and offer fresh perspectives into the region's history. And this evening, we have Senior Librarian Ong Eng Chuan to share with us highlights from the Rare Materials Collection, including significant and unique titles acquired in recent years. Eng Chuan is a senior librarian with the National Library, where he works with the Rare Materials Collection. So without further ado, please welcome Ong Eng Chuan.
Just before I proceed, I would like to share with you a brief overview of the National Library's Rare Materials Collection. Currently, the collection stands at about more than 18,000 items. It's an expanding collection. We are currently acquiring more materials. And then in terms of collection focus, being the National Library of Singapore, naturally, our priority is to preserve the printed heritage of Singapore. So our collection focus mainly on Singapore-related materials. And by Singapore-related materials, materials which are printed in Singapore, materials which have significant content on Singapore, as well as materials which are written by Singapore authors. And then we also collect materials on Southeast Asia. Being in the region, we will want to get a good understanding of our neighbors. So we also collect significant landmark titles on Southeast Asia. And we collect materials in different formats. Majority of the items in the collection are monographs and journals, but we also have maps as well as manuscript items like Malay manuscripts and handwritten documents, for example, letters by written by Raffles. And we also collect, for example, historical photographs, postcards, and art prints. So that gives you a rough idea of the items that we have in our rare collection. So before I proceed to share with you some of the materials in the collection, I would just like to mention that most of the research on these materials were done by my colleagues. So I thought that they have done pretty interesting research on these topics, these items. So I thought it would be interesting to share with you some of what they have discovered. But because the research is done mainly by my colleagues, so if my explanation is a bit sketchy, please forgive me. So I would like to begin with early European works in our collection. These early European works, for example, the earliest item that we have in our collection is a European map of Southeast Asia published in 1478. Early European works made up a large part of our collection on Southeast Asia. The first item that I would like to share with you, this small volume called Mare Liberum. As you can see, the title is written in Latin. It means freedom of the sea. This was written by Hugo Grotius, a very famous Dutch jurist and philosopher. He's mainly known for his work, his masterpiece called On the Law of War and Peace, which is considered one of the most important contributions to modern international law. This particular piece was published in 1609, and then it was published during the time when the Portuguese and the Spanish they claimed monopoly rights on East Indies. And this book was published by Hugo Grotius because he was trying to expound the idea that the seas were free for everybody to navigate and all countries are free to trade in the East Indies. So he was actually trying to establish the Dutch right to trade and navigate in the East Indies. So I wanted to highlight this book because it has a very, although remote, but a very interesting connection to Singapore, because the origin of the book actually can be traced, you know, to an incident which happened off the coast of Singapore in 1603. There was a very famous incident called the capture of the Santa Catarina. So in 1603, the Dutch captured a Portuguese ship, Santa Catarina, off the coast of Singapore. The ship was actually traveling from Macau, China, on its way back to Europe. And the ship was laden with precious goods, which they want to sell in Europe. So the Dutch captured the ship, they took the goods, and they brought the goods back to Europe, and they sold off at a high profit. And that created a lot of controversy in Europe. So the Dutch hired Grotius to write a legal justification for the Dutch action. So Grotius was working on his on this work, which was trying to justify Dutch action. But towards 1608, it seems that the Dutch and the Spanish were negotiating for a peace treaty, and it seems that the Dutch would be willing to go for the peace treaty by forgoing some of their trading rights in the East. And Grotius was not keen to the idea. So he extracted some portion of what he was writing, and then he published it in 1609, this little booklet, to further the Dutch right to trade in the East. And in fact, this was later used as one of the sources, one of the foundations for the modern Sea of the Laws. The item is currently on display at the National Library at Level 10 in the On Paper exhibition. So if you're interested, you can take a look at the item at Level 10. The next item that I would want to highlight is another Dutch title. By the 17th century, they established quite a number of bases in Southeast Asia. They made their first voyage to Southeast Asia in around 1595. And then by 1641, they captured Malacca from the Portuguese. About half a century later, they published this book called Begin End Vongen. That's just a short title. The title is pretty long. Written by this Dutch author called Isaac Kommerlein. It's actually a compilation of all the voyages which the Dutch had taken from the very beginning, 1595, all the way up to the time when it was published. Then in the following year, 1646, another edition came out, which is the edition that we have in our collection. Then another year later, they published another edition. And in the following decades and centuries, it was translated into French as well as English. It's valued by collectors because it's got many grave illustrations, although some of the illustrations were taken from other publications and other sources, like, you know, the famous German map printer Theodor de Bry. It provides an important historical source for the history of the Dutch East India Company from its beginning all the way to 1646. And it includes several important accounts of important voyages. For example, the voyage of Admiral Cornelius Matlief de Jong, which was taken around 1602. Although on paper, his purpose was to establish trading relations in the East Indies, but his real purpose was to attack the Portuguese and reduce Portuguese influence in this area. And Matlief's provide a very detailed record of the East Indies, including his encounters with the Johor Sultanate. And as you can see here, it's an illustration of Malacca, which accompanied Matlief's account, which is recorded in the book here. So this is quite an important publication on the early history of the Dutch East Indies. These are two of the early European manuscripts that we have in our collection. European studies of the Malay language has a very long history. Around the mid-1500s, the Italian Pigafetta compiled the first Malay word list based on some vocabulary list that in the Malay archipelago. Since then, there have been a lot of European studies in Southeast Asia. These two early European manuscripts were produced around 1700s, and they are interesting early European studies of the Malay language. During the late 17th century, the church authorities in Batavia quite concerned about the communities which were under their control, the sailors, the traders, and their offsprings, because these people, they were not very well educated, and they adopted a pigeonized form of the Portuguese and Malay language. I think more important to these church authorities, they adopted moral conventions which were against the Protestant teachings. They embarked on a mission to try to translate the Bible into Malay, using the pure form of Malay. So we believe that these two manuscripts were actually linked to that mission to translate the Bible into Malay. The left one is a manuscript by a Dutch missionary called Petrus van der Vorm. It's a manuscript that he did on Malay grammar, which he later published. In this manuscript, he gave a very elaborate description of the Malay grammar, and this provides a very important historical source on the study of the Malay language. And then on the right is a Malay word list. It's an anonymous manuscript. There's no name attached to the Malay word list, but it has about 150 over Malay words. And it's interesting because it provides a useful guide on the history of the development of the Malay words. For example, in the list, it uses the word kasut for shoe instead of the Malay word sepatu, which has a Portuguese origin. So as you can see, they're trying to remove any words with Portuguese or Catholic influence. So this is another manuscript item. It's an original agreement or contract that was signed in 1691 between the Dutch and the Sultan of Banten. The agreement gave the Dutch supreme control over the economic activity of Banten. The agreement was signed by 20 signatories, including the Dutch governor of the Dutch East Indies, plus four Dutch officials. And then on the other hand, from the Banten side, by the Sultan of Banten, together with four brothers and some of his headmen. You can see the signatures and seals in the image here. Top one is the 20 signatures, and the bottom ones are the ratification signatures and seals. But just to give a little bit context, Banten is located in the intersection between the Java Sea, the China Sea, and the Malacca Straits. So it commanded a very strategic location on the spice trade. And during the 1500s, it was quite a prominent trading port. So the Dutch and the Portuguese were trying to exert control over it, although both failed to do it. But in 1619, the Dutch established their base in Batavia, and then from then onwards, they began to blockade and try to attack Banten's trade. Although Banten's trade was reduced, but it still survived, and it survived by servicing other European powers. But in 1645, the Dutch negotiated an agreement with them, whereby peace was resumed. But it was broken shortly after that, and then resumed again. But in 1691, the Dutch decided to negotiate another agreement with them because of the Anglo-Dutch Treaty. They wanted to cement their control in the Java region, and that's when they signed this contract, whereby the Dutch agreed to forego all the debts that were owed by the Sultan of Banten in the past. And the Sultan of Banten agreed to recognize the Dutch economic supremacy in this region. So this is an original contract. So the item is actually currently on loan to the National Museum, and I think it's on display in the Whole New World exhibition. If you're interested in taking a look at the original, you can make a trip to the National Museum. Okay, this one is again is a Dutch title. Is Maritime Atlas produced in the mid-18th century. It's an atlas containing about 20 that was used by the Dutch VOC officials and traders to navigate in this region. It was produced by a very famous Dutch chart maker called the Van Keulen family. The Van Keulen family actually started off as bookseller in Amsterdam, and then they branched out into chart making. By the 1700s, they were actually quite prominent chart makers. They were actually appointed the official a map supplier for the Dutch East India Company. Before that, the Dutch mariners used to use manuscript charts to navigate, but with this one, replaced those manuscript charts and became it's cheaper for them to produce these charts. And this atlas is actually a compilation of charts which were produced earlier. The original charts were produced by the Van Keulen family in the 1600s, and then they were reissued in the 1700s and were compiled into this maritime atlas. Two of the maps that were worth highlighting in this volume, in this atlas, there are two. One of them is a chart which shows the constellations, the stars which the sailors used for navigation purpose. So besides the 48 constellations which were already known back then, it also includes 12 other new constellations in the southern hemisphere which were discovered during the Dutch voyages. You can see them on the left. I'm sorry, the images are a bit blur because a lot of the items that are featured now are quite recent acquisitions, so we haven't got a chance to digitize them yet. But I mean, I think this atlas is displayed here, so later if you're interested, you can take a look at the actual item. And on the right is another interesting map. It's actually a chart showing the Indian Ocean all the way from Africa, India, all the way to Southeast Asia, to China, and to Australia. And this is an interesting chart because it shows the route that the Dutch took from the west, from Europe, to Southeast Asia for the spice trade. Okay, a more recently dated item, an album containing photographs of the native people of Sarawak. It was produced around late 19th century or early 20th century. It was compiled by Charles Hoste and Robert Shelford. Charles Hoste was actually an administrative officer in the Sarawak Civil Service. Back then, the Sarawak was under Roger Charles Brooke. So Charles Hoste actually came from, he was born in England. Then he was studying in Cambridge University, but he stopped his studies because he was persuaded by his uncle, who was the bishop here, Bishop Hoste. And his uncle convinced him and persuaded him to come to seek employment in the East. So he stopped his studies and he came to the East. Through his uncle's connection, he managed to get a position in Roger Charles Brooke's. He spent more than 10 years in Sarawak, and within the year, he rose to become one of the highest ranking officer here, there, becoming the resident of a district called Baram. Baram is actually a district in the very remote interior of Sarawak. So during his time in Sarawak, he managed to get in close contact with the land as well as the native people of Sarawak. Because being the resident of Sarawak, of Baram district, one of his duties was to meet people and also to carry out the Raja's policies in the remote part of Sarawak. So he had a chance to have very intimate contact with the people and the land of Sarawak. And through his many expeditions, he collected a lot of materials on Sarawak, including specimens, as well as including he took a lot of photographs of the Sarawak people. In fact, he was also supplying natural history supplements to Raffles Museum in Singapore back then. And then Robert Shelford was born in Singapore. He was born in Singapore to a merchant family. Then he went to Cambridge to study. But unlike Hoste, he completed his studies and he got a degree in natural history. Then after that, he was employed by Roger Brooke to work as a curator in Sarawak Museum. So he also had a lot of close contact with the Sarawak people. Around 1900, he and Charles Brooke decided to compile this photo album. The photo album essentially comprises photographs of the Sarawak people as well as the land, covering mainly the Baram district area. It covers most of the native tribes that were living in the interior of Sarawak, including people like Punan, Kenya, Dayak people, and they capture their customs, their practices, their arts and craft, their architecture, their daily life, and things like that. And the album was produced in platinum print, which is a very lasting kind of photo print. On the screen here, actually, you can see the image of on the left is the image of a Dayak, a man. In the middle is actually shows a sacrificial pole outside a native village. The poles were actually used to hang heads which were hunted by the native people. When the victorious war party come back to the village, the next day they will erect a sacrificial pole outside the altar of the war god. And then they will hang the head there as a sacrifice to the war god. And then, of course, you have the picture of Charles Hoste and Shelford. Shelford left the Sarawak Museum shortly after compilation of this album. He went to UK where he worked in Oxford University, then passed away around 1912. And then after his death, his book, A Natural History in Borneo, was published. Charles Hoste, after he retired, he went back to England. And then based on the materials that he collected over the years, he wrote a lot of papers, as well as he gave a lot of lectures on the Borneo people. He also published quite a number of books. Two of the more famous ones were The Pagan Tribes of Borneo and The Natural Man, which are still considered important works on the anthropology of Sarawak even today. So I'll next move on to Singapore-related titles, because Singapore materials form the backbone of the rare materials collection. So we actively collect materials relating to Singapore. The first title that I want to highlight is this title by Raffles. I think many of you would know that Raffles was a very prolific writer. There are a lot of letters by Raffles which survive, and many institutions hold letters written by Raffles. The National Library also has a small collection of Raffles letters. This letter is quite unique because a lot of the letters are about Raffles' professional careers. and some are about his personal life. But this is the I think so far we know the only letter in which Raffles attempted to give a biographical account of himself. And he wrote this letter to his cousin, Dr. Thomas Raffles. He wrote this letter in response to something which he read in 1816. Because in 1816, the publication was actually on notable writers in Britain around the period. So there was an entry on Raffles, and in that entry, it gave a very derogatory description of Raffles, saying that he got his position in the East India Company because his wife had a illicit relationship with William Ramsay, the East India Company secretary. So Raffles was very angry when he read that. So he wrote this letter to his cousin to refute that claim. So in the letter, he gave a very detailed account of himself from his humble beginning as a clerk, as a junior clerk, all the way to his postings in the East. And in the letter, he refuted the claim by saying that, you know, when he got posted to the East Indies, his wife and William Ramsay hasn't even met. He also shows that his appointment, his promotions were all due to, you know, his own merit. And he suspects that the derogatory entry in the book due to somebody called Major Robert Rollo Gillespie. Major General Gillespie was actually the commander in charge of the forces in Java around 1811. That was a time when Raffles was the lieutenant governor of Java. There were a lot of bad blood between him and Raffles because he felt that he was passed over as the lieutenant governor of Java because of Raffles. At the time, when Raffles first came to Penang, he was appointed as the assistant secretary to the governor of Penang. Then he got to know Lord Minto, which was the governor general of India. And he convinced Lord Minto to invade Java in 1811. Then after the British invasion of Java in 1811, he was appointed lieutenant governor of Java. And then Major General Gillespie was passed over. So Major General Gillespie had a lot of resentment against Raffles. In fact, when Major Gillespie was reposted to Madras, he actually made claims saying that he accused Raffles of maladministration and corruption in Java. And as a result, Raffles was removed from Java in 1816. So there was actually a lot of bad blood between Gillespie and Java, and Raffles suspected that the derogatory description of him in the book in 1816 was due to Major Gillespie. And then he wrote this letter. So to refute that, he gave a very detailed account of his himself from humble beginning to his prominence as a lieutenant governor of Java. This is a very interesting item. It is an illustrated letter sheet produced around 1840s. It is a printed view of early Singapore showing the town area. In the foreground are some native dwellings from the waterfront of the Singapore area. So, and there is an initial BP Kisbri on the letter sheet. This was produced by Benjamin Kisbri, a very prominent missionary in Singapore. The reason why this illustrated sheet was produced was because Benjamin Kisbri actually learned art of lithography from another missionary, a very prominent missionary called Walter Henry Medhurst, when he was with Walter Henry Medhurst in Batavia in the 1830s. And then when he came to Singapore, when Kisbri came to Singapore around 1839, he started experimenting using lithography to print materials. One thing is to print Christian materials to propagate the Christian religion. Another thing is also to print textbooks. And then in the 1840s, he started using lithography to produce some of the important material that he produced. Was in 1843, he used lithography to produce the first locally printed map of Singapore, J.T. Thompson's Plan of Singapore Town. And then this letter sheet was actually produced around 1846. And this is, I think, as far as we know, this is one of two existing illustrated letter sheet that was produced by Benjamin Kisbri. The other existing copy is with the London Missionary Society's archives in SOAS, the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. This is the other one which is available here in our collection. The picture was actually drawn from the vantage point of Sandy Point, which is now Tanjong Rhu. So this offers a very a unique, early, interesting illustrative view of Singapore. Okay, this one is a proposed plan to improve the Singapore River. Most of us know that the Singapore River now is you know, a tourist spot. A lot of eateries, restaurants, clubs along the area. The river is very clean. But in the old days, it was quite polluted. Even as early as the 1800s, the river was already very polluted due to heavy traffic, because of the trading activities, and also because people were moving into the river, increased population, overcrowding. So this resulted in degeneration of the river, as well as silting. So in the old days, they used to remove the silts and debris through manual labor. Then in 1877, they set up a committee to look into it, and they started using dredging to clean up the river. But in 1898, the problem continued, and 1898, they set up another committee to look into it to try to find a solution to clean up the river. So, but nothing came of it. Then the situation grew so bad that in 1905, the colonial engineer was tasked to come up with some solution. So he came up with a few proposals, and then the governor directed those proposals to a special committee, and the special committee later forwarded the proposals to a consulting firm, a consulting engineer called Cook, Son and Matthews. Which was a very prominent dock and harbour engineer company. So in 1906, the company completed reviewing the proposals, and they submitted a report. So basically, the plan was to build to reinforce the wall, to build new walls in the river, to reinforce the river, as well as to clean up the river. Then, if you can see the red thick line on the map, actually shows the proposed building of the new walls. And then there are also some red notes made on the plan which give information on the existing condition of the river. This collection of photographs which belong to somebody called E.A. Brown. Some of you may be familiar with E.A. Brown. He published a memoir called Indiscreet Memories in 1935, in which he gives an account of his early days in Singapore. He was actually born in England. Then he came in around 1901 to Singapore as a young man to work in a company which was actually a branch of a company in Manchester where he had been working for a few years. Then subsequently, he set up his own company, E.A. Brown and Company, in 1926. He was quite a prominent figure in Singapore because he was quite involved in the social scene here. He was a very prominent figure in the musical scene. Back in Manchester, he was already an amateur actor. So when he came to Singapore, he participated in a lot of musical productions as an actor, as a producer, as a stage manager, and as well as a voice trainer. And then he also set up a drama company called Singapore Amateur Drama Committee together with six other residents. He was so prominent in the musical scene that he was in fact described as, putting the sing in Singapore. So besides his business and artistic activities, he was also a prominent figure in the civil administrative area. He was in the municipal commission for 14 years, and he was in charge of the Parks and Open Space Committee. So he was responsible for the building of amenities like Katong Park, Jalan Besar Stadium, for things like the first swimming pool at Emily Hill. So he was quite prominent in the area. Then he returned to England after the war, and he led the remaining of his life there. So he left behind a collection of photographs taken mainly during the 1920s and 1930s. These were donated by the family to the National Library. The photographs captured mainly local events, big events like opening of docks, harbors. It also captured scenes like street hawkers, New Year's Day celebrations, So for example, you can see on the screen here on the right, the shows Collects, which is a Malay traditional boat race during a New Year sports event. Then in the background, you can see the municipal building, the new municipal building, which is now, I think, which is now City Hall. And you can also see the spire of St. Andrew's Cathedral. The middle photograph, the image actually shows a production of a play called The Pirates of Penzance. And E.F. Ibar produced this play. He also played the leading role. He's a pirate wielding the sword in the image. Yeah. Okay, this is another personal photograph collection. You were actually working on this item before the coronavirus came about. This was not included because of the coronavirus. It's purely incidental. A collection belonging to Ulianta. I think some of you all may be familiar with Dr. Ulianta. Ulianta was born in Penang. Was quite a prominent personality in Penang. He won a prestigious Queen's Scholarship, and then he went to Cambridge, where he became the first Chinese medical student at Cambridge. Then he came back to Penang. Then he established the Anti-Opium Association in Penang. Then in 19, he was quite prominent and quite vocal in commenting on social affairs. Then he was also one of the editors, together with Li Bun King and Song Ong Siang, one of the editors of the Straits Chinese magazine. Then in 1908, he was invited by the Imperial Qing government in China to become the vice chancellor of the Imperial Army's medical school. That was in 1908. Then in 1910, he was tasked to go to a northern city in China called Harbin to investigate a mysterious plague, which was a lot of trouble to the city. So the plague, because of the plague, 99% of the victims who got the plague died. So it was quite a serious plague that was going on. So Dr. Wu was tasked to go there to investigate, and that plague later turned out to be the pneumonic plague pandemic, which eventually cost about, I think, 70,000 people's life in northern China. So Dr. Ulianta played a very critical role as the chief medical officer to fight the plague. He succeeded in the end. He succeeded in eradicating the plague, and he also held the first international plague conference in China. That was quite a significant event, because that was the first time a scientific conference was held in China, and was attended by scientists from USA, Britain, and other countries. He was also credited with modernizing the health and medical services in China. So in recognition of his medical work, of his fight against the plague, he was nominated for the Nobel Prize in 1935. I think the first Malayan to be nominated for the Nobel Prize. This is actually a collection of two albums of photographs recording his work in northern China fighting the plague. So it contains photographs like, laboratories, photographs of horse-driven carts carrying patients, carrying dead bodies, also showing how to wear a mask. The picture on the right is actually Dr. Wu in the laboratory. We have actually digitized the photographs, so if you're interested, you can go to our website, PictureSG, to look at these photographs. The photograph collection, together with other materials from Dr. Wu, were donated to us by Dr. Wu's family. Okay, this is another recent acquisition. It's called Magic Fan. This is actually a newsletter or magazine of a club in Singapore called the Malay Magic Circle. So it's actually a club that was forming magicians in Singapore for them together to share ideas as well as to promote the performance magic in Malaya. And then the club was formed, I think, around 1935. Yeah. So when the club was formed, one of its objectives was also to produce a periodical to spread news about the club, and also to encourage people to learn more about performance magic. So I think the first issue was produced in 1938. Then it went all the way to, I think, before the war. Despite its brief circulation, it actually contains quite a lot of useful information, including things like a list of names of members, as well as activities. He also reproduced articles from other magazines. In the beginning, most of his members were European members, but he also included some non-European members as well, included some prominent members, like, for example, the Tengku of Johor. He also included SIO Asagov, and even included people like Lee Kong Chian. Then, besides, in the magazine, besides articles on the news of the club, you also include regular columns written by people. For example, you can see the screen here, Tan Hock Chuan, who was a local member. He actually penned a regular column called Magic for All, where he teach people how to perform magic. We also have, I think, one copy on display here. So later, if you're interested, you can take a look at the magazine. Okay, this one is, the FMSR is actually a book-length poem. This is actually a poem written by a Malayan. Poem was written during the period of the Great Depression. So the poem actually talks about, covers mainly the ill effects of modernization and urbanization. And this poem is now recognized as the first major poem that's written by a local Singaporean poet. It was republished in 2013 by the local book publisher Ethos Books. So the poem actually was written by a man with a pen name Francis Ng. The poem actually provides a vignette of a journey from Singapore to Kuala Lumpur. So it describes the scene along the way. Then it talks about Malay during that time. Then in the poem, British Malaya at the time was depicted as a place where, rich millionaires from the New World came to visit. And he describes them as, having nothing to do but visiting places in Singapore like the Punggol Zoo, where they see things like live tigers, armadillos, or they go to, Raffles Museum to see stupid dead animals. And the poem ended in a very depressing mode. It ended, I think, with a scene at cemetery. So it ended very on a very low note, probably because it was written during the Great Depression. And also the poem, the poem contained a lot of notes from the author. So in it, he explained that the varying meter of the poem, he chose the varying meter because to suit the rhythm of the train. I forgot to mention that the train journey was based on a train journey from Singapore to Malaya on the Federated Malay States Railway, FMSR. So, and that's why the poem was titled FMSR. So Francis, the author's name Francis Ng was actually the pen name. So in 2013, there was actually an American studies scholar who was interested in the poem because he thought that the poem's very modernistic style and content theme seems very close to very reminiscent of The Wasteland, the poem The Wasteland, published by the American poet T.S. Eliot. So this American scholar was very interested in this poem, and he was very interested in the author. So he or she did a 2-year study, and then she managed to discover the true name of the person, who was Teo Poh Ling, a Singaporean, one of the very few early Singaporean who was English educated. He studied in St. Joseph's Institution, and then later Raffles College. And back then, he was already contributing a lot of poems and essays to Raffles College. But I think he didn't survive the Japanese occupation. So that was a bit sad. So this is another one that we have on the art scene in Singapore, the Repertory Theatre's scrapbook. It's actually a scrapbook with photographs and programs and newspaper cuttings on the Repertory Players, one of the earlier theatre groups in Singapore. This provides very useful materials if you're researching on the theatre scene in Singapore. So for example, it includes a picture of the cast of Kari Tiffin. Kari Tiffin was actually one of the few locally produced plays based on life in Singapore and Malaya. It was first staged in Singapore, then after that it was staged in London. So this is actually an early material on the local English theatre scene. This is another interesting book. This is actually a popular history of Malaya written by a gentleman called Gregory De Silva. He was actually a prominent lawyer who migrated from Ceylon to Malaya. Before this, he had written 3 other novels, and then he, in 1939, he decided to write a history of Malaya because he felt that there was a need of a simple, digestible form of a history of Malaya for the public. So he wrote this popular form of History of Malaya. So the history is actually written as a romance story. So it actually, the book actually tells the story of a married couple, a newly married couple who was on their way to Shanghai. Then along the journey, the married couple's friend tried to entertain the wife, tried to entertain the friend's wife by telling her epic tales of Malaya, beginning from the original inhabitants of Malaya to the early influence of the of India, of China, and then through to the coming of the Portuguese, Dutch, and Raffles, and the British expansion into the Malay states. Then the story comes to an end when the wife returns home because her husband passed away. Then a few years later, the wife and the friend met again, and as all good romance story goes, the wife decided to marry the friend, and they came to Malaya to live. So it tells the story of history of Malaya through the framed story of this of this romantic couple. This literary work by a prominent local writer Ku Xiao Wan. It's called Upai Si Dong Tian Hui Chu. It's actually a compilation of critiques of classical Chinese poem and Chinese poets in the history of China. So it's written by Ku Xiao Wan, a very prominent local poet who wrote a lot of poems himself, and he was very respected and was given the name Master of the Southern Poet. I wanted to highlight these copies that we have in our collection are unique because they contain the annotations of Ku Xiao Wan himself. Because you can see on the pages that he made a lot of notes, corrections, additions, and I think from those notes that he wrote, we think he wanted to reproduce another edition. But unfortunately, although Ku Xiao Wan was quite a genius in literary matters, he wasn't very successful in business. He went bankrupt, and then he died as a young man at the age of 34. He didn't manage to get the books published. But these are two unique titles that we have in our collection with his own personal annotations. This is actually a book, a translation of the game of football, the rules of football into Malay in 1895. And it's quite interesting because in the foreword, author said that he was tasked to translate this book because the game of football was getting very popular in Singapore among the local youth. But there are a lot of quarrels and fights because there were disagreements over the rules of the game. So he was tasked by the Dar Adab Society to come up with a translation of the English football rules. So this is the publication that he came up with. He actually wasn't very satisfied with his work. He was actually intending to produce a larger version, but as far as we know, we have not come across another larger version. And you can see here on the right side, I'm not sure whether it's clear enough, it shows drawing of the football field with the different positions, the English names, as well as the Jawi transliteration. So this is quite an interesting book that we have in our collection. Some of you may be familiar with the Muhammad Arif manuscript, so I won't go into it. So I'll just move on to the last section on the Tamil ones. I think the Tamil ones I'll just highlight. This is the Tamil newspaper. It's not a locally produced newspaper, but this was donated to us by Mr. Chong Ko. But it's quite an important title because this is the first Tamil newspaper in the world. So it was produced in Jaffna, Sri Lanka, around 1841. But the editions that we have is not 1841, it's 1847. And it was produced by the American Mission Press. It was actually produced by two Tamil missionaries with the American Mission Press. They produced the newspaper around 1841. It was actually a bilingual newspaper with 2 pages of Tamil content as well as 2 pages in English. And the newspaper covered a lot of topics like science, education. It also covered news on the local government. And this was produced in 1841. But although it claimed to be a scientific newspaper, because it was produced by the American Mission Press, so it was also a bit critical of the other religions, like for example Catholic or the Hindu religion. Although the editions that we have are not complete, but we're quite happy to have this newspaper, which is quite an important publication in the Tamil language publications. So we have some displays here on the table here. So if you're interested, please feel free to take a look at the display items. or do you have any other questions?
All right, thank you, Eng Chuan. Can you just give another round of applause to Eng Chuan?